Ah, bollocks.
Okay guys, thanks for joining me for another video. As you can tell by the name of the video, this is going to be about TV programmes, all about computers, not just computer games. I mean, the computer industry of ours has been going, I mean, certainly in the UK, it really took off kind of early 80s, probably 1981, 1982. With the release, obviously, of ZX81, Spectrum, etc. Now, here in the UK, the government launched an initiative called the... I've actually written it down here, called the Computer Literacy Project. Now, this was where they wanted to put computers, at least one computer, in every school. Now, if you're over a certain age, you're probably thinking, what, one computer per school? Well, you need to remember, back in 1982, computers were, you know, they were very, very uncommon. In fact, it says it was probably up to about 1984 before the high school I went to actually got their first computer. And even then, it was just one computer we had for quite a while. So the BBC launched this computer literacy programme, and what they did was they put out a tender for a company to produce a computer that would be used in all the schools and in this programme. Now, the winner of that tender was Acornsoft, who produced the BBC Model B. So that was the computer that was basically put in every school in the UK. Now, the first programme, which kicked off to kind of coincide with this, was called the Computer Programme. there's no hiding what that's about. Now, there was 10 episodes, excuse me, I'm actually reading this off, there was 10 episodes, and it was first aired in 1982. It starred, the two presenters were Ian McNaught-Davis, who sadly passed away, and a guy called Chris Serrell. So this is the Computer Programme. It's very, very serious. You know, there's really no mention of computer games. But, you know, this is what we had back in the UK, back in 1982. This is the Computer Programme.
For this, the Information Technology Year, BBC Two begins a new series now that explores the world of information science in the Computer Programme.
You may have noticed, 1982 is Information Technology Year. There's a Minister of Information Technology, and the government is even spending a great deal of money on publicising it. But what is information technology? All it really means is the world of computers. But why have they suddenly become so important, and what should we as non-computer experts know about them? Well, that's exactly what I shall be finding out during this series. One thing I know already, don't expect the computer revolution to happen tomorrow. It's happening now.
1982. Bloody hell, where did the time go? When I see this, I watch this little intro sequence, it just transports me right back in time. It's incredible how powerful something like this can be to this, sort of the human memory. Obviously the owl was a sort of a nod to Acorn, which had the owl as the mascot.
And in fact, there are over 100 different makes of small computer now on sale in Britain. You can't have failed to notice the ads in the papers for them.
I think I've probably owned about 99 of them as well.
Look at this one. Familiar faces make them seem the answer to the
Ronnie
business
Barker.
Problems. And you don't need a degree in electronic wizardry to use them, it says. And this supplement has no less than 5 ads for them. And they're all of them clearly
5?
Directed at the family.
Bloody hell.
Give your child an unfair advantage at school. And there are many specialist computer magazines on the newsstands. Again, full of very tasty adverts. Inside a day, you'll be talking to it like a new friend, it says. And now they're even starting to appear in their own TV commercials.
Ah, the video pack. I've actually got 2 of these. Bloody awful machines.
There's over 36 different cartridges. When you've mastered them.
And even when you leave the house, you can't get away from them. There are shops in the high street where you can buy a Pet, an Apple, an Acorn,
haha, Commodore Pet. My mate George has got one of them.
In fact, computers suddenly seem to be everywhere. I bet there's hardly a pub in the country which doesn't have a couple of computers.
Quicks! There we go, I was playing that in our last video actually. He's got no idea how to play it.
Like it or not, they're with us for good, but I sometimes get the feeling that the only people who'll get any use out of them, apart from space invaders, are a few highly qualified...
Space invaders, it's Quicks, man.
...home enthusiasts who, until 10 years ago, would have been making their own television sets. Well, don't despair. This series will show that the computer is within the reach of anybody, including me. And the man who'll be ably helping us with the task is Ian McNaught Davis. Mac, you've been working with computers since Stonehenge was built, I think, haven't you?
I thought you were going to come out with that remark about it being the first silicon chip.
Is that what Stonehenge is?
Just about, yes. Well, I did program those early valve machines, which had several interesting characteristics.
First, chap there, Ian McNaught Davis, sadly passed away. I think it was last year, actually.
I needed a resident maintenance engineer just to keep the things going. And they were very slow compared with modern computers. Just to give you an idea, it's a lovely...
And I know you're probably watching this thinking, my God, how dull is this, but back in 1982, this was the only program that we actually had about computers, and I was riveted to stuff like this. Couldn't get enough of it.
A Beetle today doing 600 miles an hour, 30,000 miles to the gallon. It would have lasted 10,000 years without a service, and it would have cost you 50p, so you'd have had a disposable motor car. And in comparison with those early valve machines, that watch, which has got four games on it and tells the time, probably has as much logic in it as those very early old-fashioned valve machines.
What's the secret of it?
I had one of these. I think it was the Space Invaders I had it, actually. Pretty good.
Silicon. That's what sand is made out of. It's what the silicon chip is made out of. And unlike oil, we're not going to run out of it. Every country's got some of it, and it's extremely cheap. For example, the power of this...
You having a laugh? Oil cheap?
A fairly sizable mini computer, mainframe computer.
Yeah.
One day we'll be on a chip. You'll get the same power out of a chip.
It's bizarre that mini computer's probably got, I don't know, a fraction of the power of a smartphone.
Well, even before that day comes, computers are still doing some pretty staggering jobs, many of which we take for granted, and which would simply not be possible without computer power. They range from the obviously worthwhile to the downright sinister.
Speak and spell. A computer driving a tractor. I don't think we're even near that kind of thing yet. That's what a robot looked like back in the 70s.
Mac, what is it that makes computers so very useful to us? Is it that they're cleverer than we are?
Now, they're quite stupid in many ways, but in certain ways they are very clever. They can handle a vast amount of information, and they can handle it very rapidly. And what's more, they can keep on doing it without making any mistakes, night after day after night.
He's also never used Windows 95.
Right. Well, I can understand that being applied to sending a man to the moon or running the Pentagon or something, colossal, endless computations. But for an ordinary person who just maybe wants to run a small business or something, it's very confusing. You read ads in the paper, you could spend anything from £50 to £5,000 on a computer. But what use could I get from it?
Well, of course, many of these are set up to show games. This one here, for example.
Fact 20.
You can play silly games on them.
Silly
There's
games.
It's a very important educational element of learning how to program these computers.
If only he knew.
First of all, it's fun. People enjoy it. And secondly, it's very creative. You can do very interesting and exciting things. It's boundless, the sort of things that you can actually use your creative imagination to do. And thirdly, it might turn out to be useful for your business. And there's no business that I can imagine that at some time or other won't find the use for a computer.
Right. Now, supposing I wanted to use a computer for my business. I'm a freelance journalist. I mean, let's take my example as maybe a typical one. What gear do I need? Because there's a terrifically wide range of choice.
Well, of course, you need a computer with a keyboard,
yes.
Something like this. You'd need a video screen. You'd need a straightforward cassette recorder to store your programs on, as much as anything.
Right.
Obviously, you need a printer here for printing out your letters. And if this was a bit slow, the cassette recorder is a bit slow, you can buy yourself a disk unit, which is a lot faster, and that stores it on a disk instead of on the ordinary magnetic cassette. And that's the equipment you'd need.
Right.
Okay, after that one, the BBC brought out a sort of follow-up to the computer programme, and he called it Making the Most of the Micro. Again, it was presented by the same two guys, Ian McNaught-Davis and Chris Serrell. It's pretty much more of the same. So here we go, this is Making the Most of the Micro.
Well, now on BBC Two, Making the Most of the Micro investigates the extent to which the personal microcomputer can achieve sophisticated graphics.
I love how all these intros were supposedly so high-tech, but they look incredibly dated now. But again, that music just, poof, I'm right back in 1983. There you go, that's the Acorn Soft logo. That's a film I've never actually seen, Tron. Never watched it ever.
Get them. Send out every game tank in the grid. Get them!
I should never have written all those tank programs.
Walt Disney's Tron, and as you probably know, many of the images in that film were generated using computer graphics. But if you thought that was clever, just have a look at this.
That's actually quite impressive for 1983.
Well, that short clip is an extract from a film called The Works, being made by computer graphics artists at the Newark Institute of Technology. The film has no live action at all. Every image is entirely computer generated, but presumably in not in a micro like this.
No, they had to use a mainframe.
Ah, the wee boffin.
And because of the complexity of each
Ian
image,
Trackman,
they had to take them one at a time and then put them all together to make the finished film.
So that's why it runs so smoothly and no jerks and so quickly.
Yes, but nevertheless, we can do something like that even on our little micro. You remember our little man programmes back?
Right.
Well, let's develop that idea a bit. Here we've got a different programme, and it's a loop. The interesting line is line 30, and what we're going to do.
And this is these programs. They were all very, very serious. But given that sort of computers, majority of us didn't have a computer at this point, this was still very exciting. I know it's hard to believe looking at it now, but
put a space so that as he moves across, he'll wipe out the previous image, and we'll get some kind of animation effect. Let's run it, and we can see. There he goes.
Well, you can see it's not very, doesn't fool the eye very much. It doesn't even move his legs.
Oh, no, but we can do better than that.
Mr. Picky.
Same idea, though. Here goes our little man. And this is just a series of different images rather than the one that we had before. And he's now going to do...
There's also World Games on the ZX81.
There he goes.
And so smooth it doesn't even splash.
Indeed. Well, but you may have...
Let's see him try better.
With a small image like that, even there, we have a tiny bit of blank space as each frame is computed. And so to get better than that, if we're going to do big images, we have to change the technique slightly. And let me load up a different program and show you a different approach to the problem. Now, the computer now is drawing for us a cat on the screen.
A black cat in a coal hole.
Yeah. Well, let's shine a light on it. And there we can see the cat. Now, what I've done, that cat was drawn in black. And when I, as it were, shone a light on it, what I really did was say to the computer, what you've just drawn in black, change that to white. Let's switch it off again, turn it back to black, and now we'll draw another cat next to it. Now, normally, of course, you wouldn't see this or you'd do this before you ran the program because it's impossible to wait for this kind of drawing in between animation frames.
It would look very slow and not very convincing.
Yes, but Now that we've got the cat, let's do what we did with the first cat, wipe it out. And we've still got the first cat there, so if we now animate them black to white and white to black, we can make the cat jump. Just to prove we've got two cats, let me show you. There's the first cat in red, and there's the second cat in green.
I see. And is it very complex to write this sort of software?
Yeah, it's fairly difficult to write the software itself, but the idea behind it is quite easy. Let me show you. Let's print cat.
Ian McNaught is a dick.
Aye. The colour one, which on this computer is red, let's do the same thing again. Print cat. And there it is in red. And we'll change colour again to colour 2, which is green. And let's print cat again. But that's all very straightforward. What's clever is this. We use a command which on this computer is VDU19. On other computers...
Nice Linux program in the BBC school. Did my old grade.
Done in a particular colour, change it to another colour.
Just managed to pass
so
it in the war, I got a C.
Colour one, which is red,
but I never actually took my computer knowledge any further. Other than video games.
Because that's the way the command works. And when I press return, you'll see the red turns to black. And in effect, it's disappeared. And I can do the same thing with the green cat. I can change that one to, which is colour 2, and I'm going to change that one to colour 7, which is white, and that has now gone to white. And you can see, by alternating black and white, we can create the effect that we've just had with the jumping cats.
And would you be limited just to two images?
No, we can do as many images as we've got colours to draw these different hidden characters. Let's move on, and I'll show you another programme. And whilst this is loading, you can see it's filling up the screen. The reason for that is that these pictures are stored as numbers, and I've stored a whole screen full of pictures on the disk, and I've transferred the numbers back into the computer, and we create an instant image on the screen. Now, this doesn't look very exciting at the moment. It's a couple of globes, and you can see here we've got different colour lines drawn on, blue, magenta, dark blue, yellow. That one's black and white flashing. And what I'm going to do now is to change the colours one at a time to a foreground colour, and all the others will become a background colour. It's quite impressive, isn't it?
It's very good, isn't it? So that's
there you go. That's all right. Colours
to either dark blue or light blue to get that spinning effect.
Yes, it is. But the thing about this is, it's one image and we're stuck with that one picture. To go further than that, we have to take this idea of colour switching on just a bit beyond. Let's load up another programme. And here we have a picture of an owl. And what I'm doing here is drawing each new position of its wings, and I'm rubbing out the previous one using the same idea of switching to the background colour.
It's not very fast, though, is it?
No, it does need...
Does that guy ever see anything positive?
What I've done,
Mr. Bloody Negative, seriously.
Code, and let's switch on the machine code, and there you can see...
Well, he's the guy who's trying to sell his computers.
And that's talking directly to the central processing
unit. That's actually quite clever.
Rather than having to go through the basic interpreter, which of course takes time as the program is running.
Of course, equally, you could have written it in BASIC and used a compiler, which would compile it once and for all into...
So, yeah, anyway, that is making the most of the micro.
Yes, we could have done that.
Excellent. Well, thank you, Ian. Well,
and that proved so popular that they went on to make a further program called Micro Live. Now again, it was still pretty non-gaming. They did feature games now and again. They did change the lineup slightly. They still had Mr. Ian McNaught Davis, but they brought in a guy called Fred Harris and is it Valerie Singleton. Again, it was still kind of aimed at the serious user. So this is Micro Live. This first aired in 1983.
No, it's just actually dawned on me. I've never actually watched these three programmes one after another, but it's actually the same music. I thought it was slightly different, but I think it's identical, isn't it? Once again, it features it all. Thank you.
Hello, and welcome to the last helping of a very live MicroLive. In this extended edition, a summary of the breakthroughs in computing since the 1950s, and a look at some of the exciting developments of today.
This machine is already on the market.
Oh God, there's Mr. Piggyback.
It can even tell MicroLive presenters apart.
I'll be looking at the first of a new
breed of high-performance personal computers. And there's Fred with his pink jumper.
And we'll be seeing it at one of the world's most prestigious research laboratories, the helping design of all things Chinese temples.
Well, computers have certainly come a long way since Turing's day. Current technology products include work on something called fifth-generation computers. But what exactly were the other four? The demarcations are rather hazy, but there have been definite hardware developments, computer milestones if you like, and alongside those, but not necessarily in step, there's also been developments in programming languages.
Yeah, it was 80s after all, wasn't it?
First-generation computers were
sleeves rolled up, she wouldn't look out of place in Miami Vice.
And they could only be programmed in machine code, using the ones and zeros, or ons and offs, which to this day are the only things that digital hardware can understand. Here's the world's first computer program, which would have been entered via a punched paper tape, and you needed to be a mathematician or an engineer to work with it.
1948, what the
hell? Smaller, so-called second-generation machines appeared in the 1960s, and they were a direct result of the invention of the transistor. They were, of course, more reliable, and second-generation languages, like assembler, were increasingly being used.
Still alive.
Now, assembler, or assembly
Fred.
Language, is a set of
never seen him in anything since this went off the air.
For example,
30
the
years ago.
Code to store a number in a part of memory called the accumulator just happens to be 169. But in mnemonics, it becomes LDA, load accumulator. Very much easier to understand.
But it is still not a piece of cake exactly.
One I've got one of these monitors, I think it's a cop monitor
one
for the BBC.
Instruction, which means that only any task at all needs
like
to be broken down
oven.
Into endless small steps. In contrast, one line of a high-level programming language like Fortran generates anything up to 100 machine code instructions. And by the 1960s, this was the sort of language being used by software writers who found it faster because it was easier to use and easier to understand. I mean, you get good English words, things like if, go-to is certainly understandable, write and format and so on. Now, these are third-generation languages, but they were running on second-generation machines. It wasn't until the late 70s and the development of the chip that the hardware caught up and microtechnology became known as the third generation.
This progression towards a more natural human language continues. With this fourth-generation language, Informix, it's possible to write a database application in just a few minutes, whereas, of course, with a third-generation language like, say, COBOL, it might take several weeks. I'm preparing a database about company cars. So far,
that's the thing about these very early sort of computer days. There were so much more things, different languages and different computers. Now kids, they grow up, they've just got a PC or a Mac. It's just very generic. Back then, it was everything was so new and it was actually quite exciting. Hard to believe, I know, but it was because this was just such a new industry.
And the name of the database, C for cars. Now it tells me it will be compiled, it's compiled for me, and it's been completed successfully already. Now it runs, and it's produced a blank index card. I can now enter the details for those cars, the owners, and so on. So this is an applications generator. It's a typical fourth generation.
Yeah, this plus micro plus you know,
generation machine.
What do you call it? The first two programs I looked at, they are very very dry, quite dull programs. But I say, back in the day, that was the only exposure you actually had to computers, and so it was quite exciting to a kid of the 80s.
This represents a whole new generation of.
He's got a rich tea biscuit.
The title fourth generation was forced on the world when the Japanese announced that they were working on the fifth.
Yes, the Japanese government has encouraged Japanese industry to invest heavily in fifth-generation research. They have very specific requirements,
R2D2's little brother.
They want machines that respond to the kind of language that we use every day, that learn and reason for themselves, and also there's a lot of interest in robots that can see and can
interpret these guys
what they
made
see.
Surrey
so,
then.
Where is our future research in this area going to come from? In Britain, the first ALVI research programme is currently being wound up. And only this week, European ministers failed to agree on any more funding for fifth-generation research and development as the British were dragging their heels. But there is one institute here that was set up a few years ago. It's named after Alan Turing, and it pays for its own research by selling its expertise worldwide. Fred now reports from north of the border.
So yeah, whilst here in the UK we were getting very, very sort of boring, strict programmes like that with guys in suits talking about accountancy packages and spreadsheets, in the United States they had this thing called Starcade. Now Starcade was a quiz program. It was a quiz program, but the difference was people competed at arcade games, and the eventual winner got to actually win an arcade game. As you'll see in a second, it's very 80s, very flamboyant. You know, the host and the contestants running onto the stage at the beginning. You know, it was pure 80s, 80s at its best, with flares and polo neck jumpers and that kind of stuff. Just mental. But this actually aired, when did it first come on? It came on 1982, and it actually went on for 133 episodes. It's definitely worth trying to get a grip of it, because it's pure 1980s video game nostalgia. So here we go, this is Starcade.
This is Starcade, TV's first video arcade game show, starring your favorite video games and some brand new ones being introduced to the public.
Look at these cabs.
And now, here's your host for Starcade, Jeff Edwards.
Oh, Berserk. No, it's not Berserk. Oh, it's Berserk, yeah.
Warming up for today's big match, and today, one of these teams is going to have the opportunity to win their very own RB5X programmable robot. So, players, you ready? Yeah. All set? All right, let's go play Starcade. Here we go.
As they run on the stage. Mum and Dad as well. Dad in the suit. Now, I don't mind admitting, guys, I've actually left this entire episode intact, because it's so good.
Here. Nice studio audience, welcome, nice to have you here. Now, let's meet our contestants. First of all, your name is?
Derek. I go to El Cristal, and I live in San Bruno, and I like to play baseball and soccer.
That is the longest name I've ever heard in my entire life. You, sir?
Hi, my name's Tom.
And you're Derek's father, I presume?
Father, that's right.
What do you do for a living, Tom?
Well, I'm in the computer business. I'm a branch manager for a company that sells hardware and software.
Well, you ought to be familiar with the way these games work, then. Let's meet
nice mustache, Tom.
Tim, I live in Salem, Oregon, and I like to play golf and tennis.
Your name is almost as long as Derek's was. And you are?
I'm Dottie.
I am too, sometimes, but... Oh, that's your name. I see. What do you do, Dottie?
I was recently in the clothing business. I'm now going to take Dottie. Time to play golf and tennis.
Good. I hope you enjoy your semi-retirement, I suppose that is. Welcome to Starcade. Now, as you know, our contestants are matched up based on their playing ability on today's games. And one team here is going to have the chance to win this fabulous RB5X programmable robot. There it is right there.
Woo!
You guys shake hands and get ready to play Starcade. Over to the podium.
They normally play for an arcade game, but not in this one.
The handshake's almost as long as their names. Kevin. Tell us about the five games we're going to be dealing with today.
Come on, Kev.
Well, Jeff, you know Starcade means video games, and today's lineup includes a true classic along with some new favorites. In the first position today, Bump and Jump, a frantic, bumpy, jumpy run. Next, Popeye, the man himself and all his friends. And in the middle today, Space Invaders, the old favorite, and it's still great. On to Donkey Kong Jr., as Sun tries to free Papa, and finally Tasmania, a beastly press for survival. Jeff?
Okay, team,
don't think I've ever played Tasmania, actually.
You, of course, had a chance to play them before today's show. One of them is a mystery game. You pick that in the first three games, you automatically win a prize. Now, to let our home audience know what the mystery game is, we'll ask Kevin to whisper it to him.
The mystery game is Tasmania.
Okay, Kevin,
Tasmania.
Thank you.
Tasmania.
I'm going to ask you a question. First team to buzz in answers the question, answer correctly, and you pick the first game we'll deal with today.
So, yep, while we were watching stuff like the computer time, program the and making the most off of the micro, the States were getting this.
Hey, yes.
Red.
No, sorry, the answer is brown. The two choices were A, yellow, and B, brown. And so, the Delks picked the first video game we're going to play. What would you like to play?
Space Invaders.
Dottie says she wants to play Space Invaders, so Kevin will tell us how to play that.
It's the original Space Invaders, where advancing aliens get closer and closer while firing on your laser bases. Fire back using the bases for protection. Every zapped invader scores points, and the most points of all are scored by zapping the saucer. It's a game of invaders from space.
Now, rather disappointingly, I thought that this would feature gamers who were actually really good, but as you'll soon see, they're absolutely pish.
This is the first time the younger person has let the older person decide what game to play. How come you let your mom decide, Tim?
I don't know.
Well, that's a good reason.
She twisted my arm.
Why did you pick Space Invaders?
Well, it's probably the only game I know how to play.
All right. I hope that you do well. I'll give you a couple of hints. If the mystery ship comes across the top, you can shoot it, and we don't know how many points you get for that. You get mystery points for it. When the Space Invaders come down and start turning green, you're in a lot of trouble. All right? Let's get ready to play. You'll have 50 seconds. Right over here, Tim, cheer
on. You're not going to get invaded in 50 seconds.
Ready? Get set. Play.
Come on, Dottie, do your stuff.
Okay. Get some points.
You need to try firing.
Good. Look out, look out. There you go. There you go, good.
I think Jeff, the host, he actually makes us.
Another one coming up. He's over there. There you go.
Oh, almost. He's actually doing not too bad, considering. Go, Dottie.
Dottie, you lasted. You didn't get killed off after all.
I know.
Good for you. What do you think, Tim?
Yeah, that was good.
All right, head on back. Let's bring down the next.
Now, there's one major flaw with this quiz program, which you will see soon.
Now, which one of you is going to play Space Invaders?
I am. You're going to play
it. It's all about the high scores, but you'll see. Okay, fine. Where they go wrong, what they do is they actually add the scores of all three games together, and whoever scores the highest goes through. But some games, like Space Invaders, you score very low, other games you score really high, so it means that basically whoever scores the highest score on the game that has the biggest score can technically win, if that makes any sense. What they should have done is allocate points to whoever wins, but anyway, Tom's doing quite well here.
Showing up any moment. You have another one. You have time. Plenty of time. 17 seconds. Here's that mystery ship.
Come on, Tom. You're doing so well, son.
Tom, nicely done. We'll be right back to see who gets to choose the next game in Starcade in just a moment, so stay with us.
I've got absolutely no idea. There you go, 100 miles an hour.
Grand prize on Starcade
is a dustbin.
RB5X, the intelligent robot. It's the perfect multi-purpose programmable home appliance. It learns from its experiences, moves under its own power. It can talk and even fetch the paper. Available from RB Robot Corporation, Golden, Colorado.
Oh, I don't see any hands in it, so I'm not quite sure how to pick up papers.
Oh boy, is that going to be fun for one of these families to have? Well, let's see. Both parents survived the wave of space invaders, and we'll find out what the score is. Walters, you have so far 520. Delks, you have 500. Well, we have a close game. Walter's in the lead. Of course, there's still another game to be played in this round, and then total points scored on both games will determine who gets to play the name of the game board. I have a question for you, if you're ready. Hands on buzzers, and here we go. The bagman runs through mine shafts, picking up A, money bags. Yes, Delks.
Money bags.
Money bags is right. The other choice is gold. Well, you guys know your questions, all right, and your answers. We have four games left, and one of them is a mystery game. What are you going to pick to play?
Donkey Kong Jr.
Donkey Kong Jr. Okay, that
ooh,
is the game.
Tough
it
one.
It is a tough game, I think, to play, but of course any donkey would know how to play it.
You should know, Jeff. You should know. Mario, beware of Donkey Kong Jr. He's crafty, he's fearless, and out to rescue Papa Kong from your clutches, scoring points as he climbs, avoiding the brigade of snapping jaws, ape-eating birds, and energy pods. Watch out, Mario. The son of Donkey Kong is out to rescue Papa.
Okay, Kevin, thank you. All right, let's see, Dottie, you played the last game, so Tim, you're up this time, right?
Yeah.
How are you, Donkey Kong Jr.?
I'm all right.
Well, my hat's off to you, because I cannot play this game at all. I don't know what's the matter with me in Donkey Kong Jr., but it doesn't work, so I have no hints to give you. I just wish you good luck, okay? All right, here we go. Dottie, you come over here to cheer him on. You have 50 seconds. Ready? Get set. Play it.
Not a fan of this game, I must admit. I love Donkey Kong, but I'm not too keen on this one.
Comes old Junior now. There you go.
I mean, 50 seconds. What are you going to achieve in 50 seconds? Not a great deal.
Nice jump. Way to go. Look out. That's the way to do that. Boy, you know this game. Grab the vine. Plenty of time. Look out. Nice move. Look out. Whoa. Oh,
he's actually not bad at this game, this wee guy.
Look at that, will you? Time left. Let's see if he gets some more points. About 22 seconds left. Looking for another screen. There it is. 15 seconds. Look at him go. All right. 6,300.
That'd be guys actually really good.
That's a really nice play. Head on back, Tim. You go with him, Dottie. Come on down, Derek and Tom. My gosh, I've seen screens on that I've never seen before in my life. Are you glad you're not playing this one, Tom?
Yeah, I sure am. Derek can do it better than I can.
All right, Derek, how are you at Donkey Kong Jr.?
I'm okay.
Well, let's see
I'm
if
shit.
You can do as well as Tim did. You have 50 seconds, and we'll get you ready to get set now, if you will. Tom, over here, please. Derek, all set? Ready? Get set. Play. And here comes Junior now.
You just know this wee guy's going to crash and burn.
Hang in there, Derek. About 30 seconds, still have time. That's the way to score. Oh, got you again. You have time for one more, Junior. May get some more points. About 15 seconds left. Hang in there. All right, Derek and Tom, head on back. 3,200 is the score you got. We're going to add up all the scores now that we have so far. All of you, of course, had a chance to play Space Invaders and Donkey Kong Jr. And now one of these teams is going to play for a very special prize because we're going to total up all the scores and see who gets to play the name of the game board. Walters, you have a total of 3,720. And the Delks, you have 6,800. Tim on Donkey Kong Jr. did it. Come on down here. We'll play the name of the game board. See how well you know your video games. Come on, Tim. You come too. I don't think Dottie's going to be able to do it all by herself. All right. Just down here, please. Turn around. That's it. And you turn around. There you are. A little over this. Okay. Now, behind you is the name of the game.
Shouldn't they be facing the monitors so they can actually see it?
Games. If you name the games correctly, you're going to win a good prize. Does that sound good to you, Tim?
Yeah.
All right. How about you, Dottie?
It sounds wonderful.
All right. One of you's got to go first. Who's going to go first? Dottie, you will go first, then Tim.
She can.
All right, turn around,
you
please.
Cheeky little sod.
The screens in the upper left-hand corner.
All right, here we go, yep.
Is that Roundup or Robbie Roto?
Robbie Roto.
No, sorry, one wrong. In the second screen, Tim, is that Berserk or Frenzy?
Frenzy.
Frenzy.
Frenzy is right. Okay, number three, is that Pop Flamer or Poppin' Balloon?
Pop Flamer.
Good guess, Dottie, you got it. And Tim, the final one, is this Looking or Eyes?
Eyes.
Eyes is right. You got three out of four.
Didn't know the last two.
Turn around. And Kevin, I'll tell you what prize you're going to get.
What have you won?
It's a White's metal detector featuring ground exclusion balance to help you locate coins.
Excellent.
And precious metals.
These are all the rage back in the 80s metal detectors.
Metal detector from White's Electronics.
All right, nice going, Dottie and Tim. You're in the lead, but there is one more round to play, and we'll be back to play the final round and see who's going to get a chance at that robot. We'll be right back. We're at round two. There's only one game left to play. But before we play that game, Tom, somebody told me besides being in the computer business, you were a songwriter.
Yeah, that's right, Jeff.
You have a song you'd like to do for us?
I just happen to have it here. Shall I go ahead?
Sure. Why not?
Okay. Starcade really makes our day. We like Starcade all the way. Video games are lots of fun. Made to play for everyone. Mom and dad and children too. Big folks, little folks, and teenagers who want the new technology. Experience is what you see. Oh, 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 Starcade.
All right.
Yeah, okay.
Terrific. That'll probably be an arcade game in about another 3 weeks. Okay. This is round number two. As I said, only one game left to play. This time only 40 seconds to play it. After that, we'll total up the scores in all the games. And the top scorer will get a chance to win the RB5X robot. So, teams, if you're ready, here's your final question. Hands on buzzers. In Griplop, when the ball turns red, you can A, score no points. B, score bonus points. Yes, Delphs.
B.
No, sorry, it's A. When the ball's red, you can score no points. And that means the Walters get a chance to pick the game. We have three games left. Tasmania, Popeye,
Tasmania.
And Jump, and one of them's a mystery
Tasmania.
Game. Popeye. Popeye. No mystery sound. The mystery game was Tasmania. But Popeye's a terrific game, and if you play it well, you get some points. Kevin will tell us how to play it.
Well, blow me down, mates. It's me, Popeye, catching hearts, musical notes, and words of love tossed to me by my sweet olive oil, performing me duty by punching out a few obstacles thrown in me way, and giving Bluto a lickin' after I've had me spinach. Fighting off the sea hag with me friends Sweet Pea and Wimpy putting in an appearance. What a way to spend me day, cause I'm Popeye the Sailor Man.
I love it. Okay, Tom and Derek, who's going to play Popeye?
Me.
Okay, do you know much about Popeye?
Well, yeah, if you kick the can.
Yeah, well, grab the spinach. Yeah, kick the can is kind of a hide-and-seek game, yeah, but that's okay. I'll give you another little hint, and you all might want to listen to...
He's a child, for God's sake,
Popeye
Jeff.
Popeye opens up, he's on the left side of the screen.
Cut him some slack.
Bluto comes over and wrap him around behind to the other side. Bluto will come back and turn his head around, and you can pop that punching bag and drop the bucket on Bluto's head, okay?
Yeah.
All right, that's advice. You don't have to follow it, but it'll do make you some points if you can. Tom, get ready to...
I'm considering he's got 50 seconds. It's unbelievable.
Ready, get set, play.
He's got 40 seconds.
Yes,
you need to start moving.
Whoa, but down too soon. It's okay, there's a spinach. Got the spinach. Okay, here we go. Look out.
He's shite.
A little bad luck for you, but let's head on back. Going back there, Derek and Tom and Tim and Dottie, come up. That's a tough game unless you get them all in the right place. Okay, Tim. Tim will straighten it. You put it where you want it, Tim. Okay, there you go. Who's going to play this game?
Timmy.
Okay, Timmy, you know Popeye pretty well?
Yeah.
You hear the advice I gave to Derek?
Yeah.
You think you're going to follow it?
Shiny here.
All right, we'll see what happens. Get ready to play. 40 seconds. Ready? Get set. Play. Here comes Bluto.
This we go. Show us how it's done.
Catching a couple of hearts. Higher up the catch, the more they're worth. A couple of punches there. Good punch. Good. Money. time, 15 seconds. Good moves. Got the spin. Drop to the middle. That's a trick. You got Pluto. Good for you. 3,500. Nicely played, Tim. Congratulations. Dottie and Tim going back. What we're going to do now is total up all the scores.
I think we know who's going to win here, considering they were leading to begin with.
Well, we've had a good day of play, the father and son team and the mother and son team, and I'm glad to have met all of you here on the show. Now we'll total up the scores and see how we did. The Walters have a grand total.
You can at least try and sound sincere.
The Ducks have 10,300. Terrific. You guys are the winners for sure. Congratulations. Walters, I'm glad
Dottie to meet you. Delk.
Thanks for the song, Tom. That was really nice. Sure, nice to meet you, Derek. Good luck. We have some nice gifts for you. And the Delks, of course, you have won a very special prize for being our winners of the day. And Kevin will tell us about that.
It's the Texas Instruments Home Computer.
Hey, that's my first computer.
Education, home finance, and entertainment. You're not just playing, you're learning with the
home finance
from Texas Instruments.
All right, that is yours. Also waiting for in the wings is a robot. If you can do it, we'll find out. We'll see what happens right after this.
I think the Texas computer is probably better than the bloody robot, but anyway.
Some of our contestants and some members of the studio audience will receive Trigger Elite, the high-performance joystick from Electra Concepts with select sensitivity settings, rapid-fire bar, 5-year guarantee, and more. Your video system's complete with Trigger Elite. And GameLine, the incredible new way to play an endless stream of video games with just one cartridge through your telephone. GameLine, the only way to try new games at home before
incredible.
You buy. Games are only the beginning. And Zonix video games with the exclusive Double Ender. Two amazing games on one cartridge. Multiple screens and unbelievable graphics.
Double
Zonix
Ender.
New cartridges, spikes,
I can just
beacon,
imagine
Ghost
some
Manor.
Northern
Zonix,
that.
More fun for the price of one.
Yep.
Okay, welcome back to Starcade. And now, Tim and Dottie, the chance to win your own robot. There's still two games left unplayed, Tasmania and Bump and Jump. During a commercial break, we informed you that if you picked Tasmania, you'd have to score at least 921 points. If you picked Bump and Jump, you'd have to score at least 1,714 points. Those are the average scores of more than 20 other players who played these same games. And you reached a decision, and you picked?
Tasmania.
Tasmania. Okay, that means if you score 921 points or more in 30 seconds, you're going to win our grand prize, RB5X the Robot. So while Kevin tells us about Tasmania,
at least try and look bloody enthusiastic, son.
You're just a little
I don't really blame him.
So
he was hoping
yourself,
for a Robotron cab.
Runs out, the walls close in, and defeat could be a crushing experience. But while you can zap and run, if an escape exit comes, take it for even bigger rewards. It's Tasmania.
Okay, you need to get 921
Never
points.
Never seen that game before.
Seconds, and you're going to play it, right, Dottie?
Oh, no.
Look at the Tim's face when I said that. I know you want to play it, Tim, right?
Yeah.
All right, my friend. 30 seconds to get 921 points or more, and the robot is yours. You ready? Yeah. Get set, play.
So it's actually kind of Robotron. Interesting. I'll let you give that a wee playthrough. One time.
Get him if you can. Walls are closing in. Oh, no. 50 is what you got. You needed 921. Valiant try, though, Tim. Congratulations to you, Dottie. To you, too. You both.
There we go. That is. That is mighty Starcade. Just going to go to YouTube. There's quite a lot of these actually available to watch. Brilliant fun.
And g4tv.com/starcade.
Aye, pretty mental stuff, eh? anyway, after Micro Live, I don't know when that stopped airing. I think that stopped airing kind of mid-90s, sorry, mid-80s, probably 85, 86. There was really no sort of TV programmes at all here in the UK until 1992, when ITV released a programme called Bad Influence. Now, it featured two presenters, Andy Crane and a girl called Violet Berlin. Now, she actually used to write for kind of computer and video games. She was a bit of a kind of celebrity in the sort of computer magazine circles. The Bad Influence, it used to feature, it would review hardware, it would review video games, It used to get kids on to review games and that kind of stuff. It wasn't, I mean, I watched it a few times. It wasn't the most, it wasn't my favourite video game show, but you know what? We didn't have very much back then, so this is a bad influence.
I could never quite figure out what these characters at the start are supposed to be, the dinosaurs or something? Another odd choice. And apologies about the quality of this particular video, there's just not any good footage of this TV programme at all out there.
Hiya, welcome
it
to
does get better, though.
The only place you'll be able to see moving screenshots of the very latest game. Check this out, Streets of Rage 2.
And the main review this week is Joe and Matt Caveman Ninja on the SNES. Our panel give their opinion.
And I'll be reporting from the world's leading...
Yay, there's one for Big Cocaine Ian.
And it's pretty dangerous,
he doesn't have.
I can tell you.
Z Wright, our American reporter. And we'll be seeing more of Z, including the rest of his face, later on in the programme.
This was very 90s styles, everything.
Why? Well, we've got such a range of equipment. Everything from this... Remember this, the 10-year-old BBC Micro, to the very latest in handhelds that Kate's got here. This is called a quick shot supervision. What are you playing on it?
I'm playing Chris Ball.
Never seen that before.
Whatever you've got, it'll be here somewhere. This one's a Neo Geo, one of the most advanced consoles in the world. But as well as games, we'll be looking at the other amazing things computers can do.
So yeah, this programme used to look at computers and video games. I mean, it was 99% video games, but it did look at serious stuff as well.
If you use a computer to do your painting, you can do all the things that pens and papers can do, and more. For example, I can do freehand drawing here, but then I can choose a square brush and a bigger brush, any size or shape, and a different colour at the flick of a switch. And, that O's not very good there, so I can choose any shape I want, be it a square or a circle.
Has anybody actually used a Lux Paint? I think the furthest I ever got with it was loading up the Tooting Cameroon picture and
really quickly,
making it colour cycle. That was about as far as it
went. Using rulers for lines, you can say where you want your line to begin, where you want it to end, let go, and hey presto. And you can use this airbrush.
Although having watched that History of the Amiga, the Bedroom Mr. Billions thing, they were actually talking about how Deluxe Paint was so far ahead of its time, and it was the tool which they used to do the graphics back in the day, so...
Okay, and one of my favourites is this, it's called Colour Cycling.
Yeah, you can hear the sounds a bit weird. I think it does settle down.
And keep forever. Actually, this one's not very good, is it? I think I'll give it to Andy as a present.
I don't think Rolf Harris has got too much to worry about, has he? Well, we're looking at other paint packages in the series, including this, which is Super Mario Paint, which will be available for your SNES after Christmas. In the meantime, though,
we do
want to hear from you. If you've got computer-generated pictures, animations, graphics, anything we show on telly, we'll get this. Go on. The Bad Influence
Studio
T-shirt.
Actually looks more like
anything to do with computer games, consoles, video games, and we'll give you the address to write to at the end of the programme. In fact, the address and loads of other bits of information will be in what we're going to call the Data Blast. To access it, all you need is this, your humble video recorder. Video the last minute or so of the programme, including the credits, which is the boring bit where everybody who made the show's names goes across the screen. Then when you've done that, rewind it and play it back. But don't play it back at full speed. Using your pause and your frame advance, if you've got one on your video, spool through it slowly, and up to 50 pages of information will be at your disposal, including, look at this, some excellent cheats.
There you go, that's what we did for information before the internet.
Ah, hello you slimy furtlers.
Now this guy gives out tips. It's actually quite funny.
Quite frankly, you haven't. Right, we're going to start with something really easy for those of you with small brains and blue hedgehogs. Sonic. When he appears on the screen and waves his finger, press up, down, left, right, then quickly hit the A and start
probably the most,
all the levels are then listed on the screen.
Magazine-like so TV programme, you know, with tip sections and computers and reviews and that kind of stuff. It was pretty general, the stuff it covered.
Charming, that Namrud. You can't believe a word he says, except when it comes to tips and tricks. And there'll be more coming up in Data Blast at the end of the programme, so watch out for that. Now, every week we'll be reviewing the latest games. Our reviewers are all keen players, and they'll be trying out the games and letting us know what they think. this week's main review is Joe and Matt Caveman Ninja on the SNES. It's a prehistoric action-adventure.
Okay, this is great fun to play. It's really fast. It's good graphics. Oh, I've just fallen down a hole. When this happens, a little angel comes up. You jump over, you've got to hit all the pterodactyls, fall down another hole. Jump over. What you've got to do is you've got to kill all these Neanderthal cavemen. And they stole all your women folk. So you've got to battle through each level to kill that. There's lots of good things to do. Jumping, hitting people with your clubs. Basically, you've just got to run through and save everyone.
It's a game I've never really played much.
Okay, I'm now on level 6.
And always thought it looked really nice as well.
I just picked up some rocks. They're different weapons. It's a great fun game. The graphics are smooth and cartoony. The sound effects are excellent, especially on this level where it sounds as though you actually are in the cavern. I've just hit two Neanderthal men with my rock, and now I'm running up to get the bonus, which is extra health. All the platforms are slippery on this level, which makes it give that added realism. The music is different on every level, and that adds to the game. It makes it really addictive, and it's easy to pick up as well. It gets progressively harder as you go on. There's different dinosaurs, lots of different baddies, and it stops you getting bored. And the good thing about this game is, if you've got a friend, there's also a two-player option. One of the best things about it is these end-of-level sprites. It's great fun to play.
£49, there you go. I think we're bad off paying £49 for a game now, but look at what you're getting nowadays.
It's such a simple game, but it's really brilliant, and the graphics have sounded great.
So the final scores for Joe and Mac. The boys gave it 4 out of 5, and the girls gave it 4 out of 5.
Go and get a pen and paper for this one. Pauses. Continues. The word of the week is level code. Well, actually, it's two words. It's a way of jumping levels that you've already completed in a game. For example, this is a game called Dr. Franken on the Game Boy. At the start of the game, you can choose to enter a level code. Of course, there's only two ways you can discover the codes. After each level, they're displayed on the screen, or you can copy this down. You'll start on level 4, Triassic.
Now, at this point in 1993, satellite TV had launched, and along came, it was Sky. In fact, what was it called? B-Sky-B, I think it was, and then also Sky, they came along as well. Now, Sky launched their own video game program, and they called it Games World. Now, I think it used to be on every single day. The other programs that we're kind of looking at were all weekly, but this Games World came on every single day. It featured some hosts, Bob Mills. He was the presenter of the show, and it had what can he set it apart, whether it was good or bad. It used to feature it had like characters. There was Dave Perry, who was known as a games animal. And there was other kind of characters dressed up as like a wee schoolboy, and there was all different types. But they were actually all really, really good at video games. And what they would do is they would bring out, so I think was it 3 or 4 members of the public, and they would all compete. And then the winner would then go on to play one of the sort of the Games World experts. So this is Games World, and this was on Sky.
From the Sky Satellite Network, this is Sky One with Beat the Elite.
I never had Sky until up to just a few years ago, so I never ever saw this back in the day.
It came. The end of the world as we know it. But one thing survived. They could not break its following. The game.
Slightly higher production values than other ones we've looked at, I think. Now, I know this is called Beat Elite, but this is part of the Games World thing.
you. It's Friday here on Games World. So what have we got? We've got Beat the Elite. We've got two champions. We've got Mangatsu from Monday, and we've got Simon from Wednesday. You know what happens? They come to come to all that trauma. They've now got to go head-to-head with each other, and only one of them is going to go up against the Videators, the toughest, baddest bunch of players on the planet. It's Friday. What else can it mean but Mr. Tim Boone?
Thanks very much indeed, Bob. Well, of course, it's Friday.
I remember him for Gamesmaster.
Past six, you know what that means. It's playtime.
It is indeed. Let's have a look at our two contestants. Let's see what they thought about tonight's contest.
My name is Mangatsu. I'm Monday's winner. I've seen Simon play, and he's just a beginner. So watch me take him out.
My name's Simon, and Wednesday I was at the top. I've seen Mangatsu play, and he was a flop.
So they're both champions, but only one of them's going to go all the way. Do we want to see them?
Yeah!
Well, then bring them to me now!
That was obviously trying to appeal to the younger generation.
With and Simon, two super cool players. We've seen them perform before. Now we're going to see how they get on against each other. You feel confident?
Very.
Yeah, you feel good?
Yeah.
Well, they've had a good few days on Millsy Island to get their fingers working and to get their sneers in order, I noticed, Simon. Well done for that. Now we're going to see how they perform against these other gentlemen. Take your position, please, at the console.
Well, they may look mean, but they're up against the toughest game in the entire world, the legend of living rooms across the land, the one and only Cash Dash. 60 seconds to race around the screen, collect as many coins as you can, avoid the robots, pick up the icons. Mangatsu's in blue, Simon's in green. At the end of this, there's one winner and one down and out.
That's exactly how it works. We know you've been through a lot to get here, but this is the big head-to-head. OK, whoever wins is through, whoever loses
taking it so seriously.
Off. Best of luck to both of you. Let's play.
Okay, once again, Simon's in green at the top, Mangatsu is in blue, his stack of coins at the bottom. Now, both these guys do look very mean, but this is going to be the test. Now, the idea of this game, as everybody knows, is to go for as many coins as possible, find the clusters, and at the moment, Mangatsu in blue has found the best cluster up at the top there, and he's at the bottom, and he's racking up more points than Simon at the top in green. Mangatsu's definitely got the run of this at the moment. He picked up a speed-up icon there, but he's just been thwarted by a robot. Now, as you can see, the guys can punch each other, so we'll try and thwart each other, punch each other out of the way. They're just below the 30-second mark, they're halfway through, and at the moment, Simon's come back from nowhere to run into the lead in green. Simon in green has found a good cluster. He's found out how to beat the robots. Mangatsu's having trouble, and it's dead level at the moment. Both the guys are going back, they're trying to scrap on the bridge. If Mangatsu can go forward, he's going to get all the coins, but Simon gets there first. Simon's got all the coins. Mangatsu can only follow and pick up what's left. Simon's ahead. The crowd likes Simon. They're yelling for him. At the moment, it's always running out of time, and Simon wins. 62.
So that was the game that they used to use to kind of, as a head-to-head.
Simon, you've got 62 points. Welcome to Games World. Welcome to Beat the Elite and the toughest half hour of your life. Mangatsu, you got 45. Goodbye.
Mangatsu, unlucky. You did very well to get here. You've been champion for a week. But now, this money
is going to go through. Oh, look
who sad he is. Mangatsu, goodbye. Take him away, gentlemen.
Poor Mangatsu.
So, you're going to go through. You've got the biggest challenge of your life coming up. You've got to play the Videators. How do you think you're going to do?
I'll probably beat them.
You think so?
Yeah.
Well, let's see.
It's the Videator Challenges.
And Simon, your first Videator Challenge tonight is the one and only Street Fighter Turbo on a Super Nintendo. Not only that, we're playing at Super Turbo speed, 6 stars fast. Two fighters, battle it out. 3 rounds, 1 winner, Turbo.
You got 62 points. Before we find out which of the Videators you're up against, we have to ask you how many of those.
Yeah, there was different characters. And then I think they spun a wheel
20.
Or something.
20! 20, yeah. That's looking good, they like it. Let's see who it's going to be. Press the button.
The Videator who will challenge you is Master Moriarty, the snob amongst the slobs, the toff amongst the toughs. He's the upper crust technocrat. Can you outclass him?
Please welcome Master Moriarty!
And now, from Games World,
I don't know where they got all these people with these Videators, because they were all really, really good. Yeah, you could have played video games, I'm assuming they must have had some sort of addition or that of competition.
Hello,
Now, just to go over that again, Nanny. That's one train set, one racing car, another SNES for my collection, another Neo Geo for my collection, one teddy bear, and 400 mile bar for dear old big boy Barry. Okay, now can you post that tonight, please, Nanny? Goodbye.
That's the Christmas list, is it?
Yes, that's right, Mr. Mills.
Oh, lovely. Let me introduce your big present. This is Simon, who I think may be about to parcel you up and deposit you under the tree, because he's a mean player. He's bet 20 points that he can get a beat-em-up on you in Street Fighter. What do you think?
That's insults mean nothing to me, Mr. Mills.
Right, well, let's see how you can play. Gentlemen, take your positions at the console. So, Tim, Master Moriarty on a beat-em-up.
Absolutely.
How's he going
to
do?
Well, if this was in the playground, if this was for real, you'd have to give it to Simon, wouldn't you? I mean, no contest. But this is Turbo, this is on the SNES, and Moriarty is good. He's chosen Vega. Very fast character, great attacks, Barcelona drop, rolling crystal flash. Simon, he's gone for Chun-Li. Very fast character as well. Great special moves. This is going to be really quick.
Best of three, but if somebody wins the first two, obviously we'll call a halt there. Gentlemen, if you're quite ready, let battle commence.
Okay, this is going to be fast. For everybody at home, Moriarty's on the left, and Simon as Chun-Li is on the right. Both the guys sizing each other out. Moriarty tried a Barcelona drop, but it didn't work. Both the guys just sorting out, trying to work, use their special moves. Simon's just moving in, testing out Vega. Both these guys are a bit scared of the sheer speed of this game, because it's moving at 6 stars. It's very fast. But Vega got the drop there. Moriarty's moving in. Great drop from the side of the screen by Moriarty. Moves in with a crystal flash. What can Chun-Li do? Great drop again. There's very little that Simon can do here. Moriarty's got the upper hand, but fighting him off. Simon very wisely tries to reorder, but it's all over first round.
Moriarty, you got his arse
whipped. To Moriarty.
Gentlemen,
fight on. Simon's going to try and find something very special here.
Actually, you know what? I mean, this program, a lot of people said it was absolutely garbage, and I was probably one of them, even though I never really watched it much. But it's actually probably one of the most kind of serious, you know, game challenges. You actually got proper video gamers playing each other, so for that purpose, it was actually pretty entertaining. And Gamesmaster was all about the challenge rather than sort of one in one. This was actually video games,
Simon,
taking each other on.
Simon, you thought you were great, but you're up against the best, and you've paid the price. You're now on 42 points.
Master Moriarty, another superb performance. Well done. Any words of advice for him at all?
I dare say if I had Sky at this point, I would have definitely watched this.
Just don't be predictable.
Yeah, don't be so predictable. Okay, hopefully we'll see you again before Christmas. But if not, I've got an orange and a walnut for you. Nanny, it's about his bedtime, I think. Master Moriarty!
That is Games World.
So 1992, what launched was probably the most loved, and certainly in my opinion, the best computer video game program, Gamesmaster. It was presented by a Scottish guy called Dominik Diamond, and it also featured, he was actually a very well-known astrologer called Patrick Moore, Sir Patrick Moore. He played the part of Gamesmaster. Let's take a wee look at it.
Ah, iconic. That was the sound of a Thursday night. Couldn't wait for this. Interestingly, when I was talking to Dominik Diamond in an interview, he actually auditioned for The Word, which was an adult programme on Channel 4. But he didn't get the gig.
While I'm playing with my organ in a crowded church. Well, this is Gamesmaster, television's only video game magazine show, coming to you from the only church in the country where Harry Secombe is too fat to fit through the door. But nevertheless, we've managed to squeeze an ample portion into tonight's slot, with news, tips and game reviews guaranteed to have people stealing from their parents' purses to purchase them. But we'll begin tonight with our initial game-playing challenge, and to detail it, I hand you over to the Celestial Godfather, the Games Master.
Hello. How kind of you to join me once again. I have to admit to being rather pleased with the three little challenges I've managed to concoct for you this week. To tee us off, we take to the fairways and putting greens of Top Players Golf. If you wish to complete my challenge successfully, you will need to play the first three holes on the country club course in level par.
It's only when you look back at Gamesmaster and you realise just how risk some of the comments that Dominik made. I mean, obviously I was an adult and I was watching it, so I picked up on most of them, but most of the kids would have gone right over their head. You know, the sort of, you're going to be in your bedroom waggling a joystick, stuff like that.
I understand you're a bit of a mean golfer in real life.
Well, that's right. I play at Ross and White Golf Club and I have a handicap of 4.
Right, okay. Now, how do you fancy your chances on the computer equivalent?
Prefer to be doing the real thing, but I'll give it a go.
Okay, if you'd like to get the feel of your clubs in our hot seat, we'll get ready to
feel. Feel of your club.
And trying to keep me on the fairway is my own little handicap, Neil West from Sega Power. Welcome, Neil.
Thanks very much, Dominik.
Now, any general tips?
Yeah, they used to bring in various sort of gaming journals, Julian Rignall, Tim Boone, this guy, various ones. And then, of course, most infamously, Dave Perry, Dave the Animal Perry. We had the big strop in Series 6 with the Super Mario Gate. Super Mario 64 game, but he claimed he'd never actually got to play the game and was set up.
Okay, well, he's taking a wise precaution of having a look about the course before he starts, yeah? He's got to set himself up for his shots, and so it'll have worked out that he needs a shot onto the first fairway.
This is actually quite a good game, I've played it a few times. Obviously via emulation, don't have a Neo Geo unfortunately.
He's now set up very nicely indeed. Okay, now we're coming up for the second stroke here. Okay, he's using a 4-iron, and he missed. Right, this meter up here, he's gone for a 100% strength shot, which is quite risky, because he now runs the risk of either slicing or hooking it. Oh, is it going to run out in the fairway green? Yes, it's on the go. Oh, no, it's gone too far. Oh, my word. Just slipped off of the green there into the rough at the side, but nevertheless, quite a good stroke. Almost an excellent shot. Very, very good indeed. He's picked himself a sand wedge, a little chip shot. Delicate chip. Oh, my word, he was nearly sunk it there. But he's left on the green for his par putt. Okay, he's got to get a par to stay in the running for the challenge. He's got a par each hole, so it looks like he's okay on this one. If he can just get this part. And it's in there.
He's done it.
So now we're going on to the second hole. Quite a tricky, thin little hole, this one, Neil. Yeah, that's right. There's a couple of really nasty bunkers, and if he really takes a swipe and mucks it up, he's going to end up in the sea. He's picked himself a one wood, and off he goes. 100% whack. Oh, and he wallops and that one. And it looks to be doing okay. What a nice stroke. Couldn't have been much better, could it? Lovely first stroke there from him. 213 yards. That really is a very good shot. Okay, now he's going to whack it again there. Is he going to stay on? Oh, he may have just over the net. He may well be going for the bunker here. And just, oh!
Yeah, apparently the golden joystick's just were quite literally just, was it Quickshot 2 joystick's painted it gold? Yeah, 90 yards. And Dominik himself never actually got one.
Or he's going for pitching wedge as it happens. Give him a little bit more lane. That's right, especially when you consider he's in the rough.
Interestingly, you never actually see them on eBay. I mean, there must have been quite a few, you know, one over the years. I mean, there were 7 seasons in total. With quite a few, there must have been about, I don't know, good, maybe a couple of hundred golden joysticks handed out, but I dare say a lot of them were probably chucked in the bucket back in the day.
And to win the challenge, you all need to do is stay on par. That's right. A nice little chip up. Oh my word, it could be going in. Oh! That was a beautiful little shot. And he should be set up here for the par, Neil. He should. If he misses this, he'll never forgive himself.
Uphill to the right.
Okay, look at the slope in the bottom left-hand corner. Right. You can see that the green's sloping from bottom left to top right. A bit more power required. Bit more power.
That's what I would do.
Word. And now he's left himself a dreadful shot to try and get back. This is a very tough shot. Just a little bit too much power in this putter. Yeah, beginning to feel the pressure, I think. So we really must...
But he did it.
Right. Okay. Now, it leaves it very interesting because he must have a birdie on this final hole, Neil. So he's really got to get on the green with this opening shot.
He certainly has.
And he's given it a thwack. Come on, he could be... Oh, no, it's fallen a bit short. Oh, no, he's going to go in the bunker. Now, this is his last stroke, Neil. Basically, he's going to need a miracle from this position.
He certainly is. It looks as if the only thing he'll come away with is a dinner date tonight.
Okay. Oh, good. Oh, no. Oh, my word. He's got the ones. Oh, no. So that means that Mark has gone over par and his challenge has sadly ended in abject failure. Bad luck, Mark. you started off very well, parred the first hole.
Now, Dominik Diamond, he was the presenter in for seasons 1 and 2, but not in 3, because they wanted to use McDonald's as a sponsor, and Dominik Diamond refused to do the refused to do it on that basis. So they found somebody else, who we shall see in a second. And needless to say, this guy, Dexter Fletcher, he only lasted one season. He just, I mean, people just didn't like him. I mean, it was probably a bit of a shame, because at the end of the day, he had a big shoes to fill. You know, Dominik Diamond was the face of Gamesmaster, and to stick a Cockney in there rather than, you know, when it's a Scottish guy, the guy who's basically been set up to fail. I did still watch it, I have to say, but it just wasn't the same. The guy tried his best, but fortunately Dominik decided to return for season 4.
Hello and welcome to the all-new thumb-numbing joystick thrashing Gamesmaster. Sadly, this poor chap burned himself out on level 2, but you'll be pleased to see that Auntie Marisha survived intact.
Now, apparently when I was talking to Dominik, that was the original red coat, and they did actually get rid of it, which upset Dominik greatly. So yeah, this one tried to be more edgy, more, oh, I might, in your face type thing, but it just didn't work. And, you know, fortunately, Hewland International, who produced the Gamesmaster, decided to bring back Dominik for season 4, 5, 6 and 7. Now this is, this particular one is episode 10 of season 6. Now I've included it for a reason, which you'll see in a second. Every season got edgier and edgier, with the jokes being more adult. He was trying to sort of hide it less, it was less subtle. And that's why this programme did appeal to not just kids, but to kind of grown men as well. Dominik did date one of these girls, I can't remember what one it was, he did tell me. I don't know whether it was the blonde one or the dark haired one.
Good evening and welcome to Gamesmaster, and a very happy new year to every man, child and especially woman out there, because we're celebrating 1997 with a girly special. Yes, everything in today's show has a distinctly female flavour, because let's face it, if the girly show can get a second series, there's hope for all us sisters. Later on in the show, the woman who's responsible for more worn-out pyjamas than any other, Zoe Ball, will be joining us. But first, we begin with today's event, which, keeping with the girly theme, we like to call Platform Queen.
I like to keep a close eye on my female games playing contingent, so I was particularly interested when I heard about a young lady who goes by the name of...
They never really changed the format of Gamesmaster. I love the programme, but some of, you know, I think they could have maybe tried to change it slightly, just to keep it fresh, but they never did. It was always just based on some challenges and reviews and that kind of stuff.
30 DNA triangles on the rather creepy spider. And then on to Crash Bandicoot to gather 20 apples. She's not been allowed to see any of the levels she's been playing on, and we have only 4 minutes to complete them all. Of course, if she dies at any time, then her challenge will be over. It's a difficult one, so come on, Platform Queen. All the sisters are rooting for you.
Okay, so like we said at the top of the show, this is the girly show, all us girls coming together. Please welcome the first one, Sarah Wade.
Every season had a different sort of theme to it. This one was under the water, or under the sea.
Well, I've completed every single one of the Mario Brothers.
Both of the Donkey Kong, and I just love playing them all, Rayman, everything.
Uh-huh. What about your mum and dad? Do they share your passion?
Yeah, everyone in our family loves it.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Did your mum and dad end up in hospital or something because of that?
Yeah, they were playing too much and they had carpal tunnel syndrome in the wrists because they were playing too much.
Is that a syndrome I've had for different reasons? Finally, you said you'd like to see more women on Gamesmaster. Why is that?
Definitely. Because it's, there's so many males on the show. There's a male presenter and everything else.
We hope. We think. Well, what would you do? What would you like to see them doing then on the show?
I'd like to see them sharing your job. You know, presenting
right.
as well.
Uh-huh. Presenting with me basically up here getting close to a woman.
The funny thing is, if you watch the interview I did with Dominik, he was saying that after season 6, they actually thought that was it was finished, and they didn't expect to do any more, and then Channel 4 came back to them and said, right, when he starts season 7? And they thought, well, no, we're not going to do another season. So basically, Channel 4 forgot to cancel it. So they did go on to make a seventh series. This is actually a really good game. I've got this on my PlayStation 3, I think it is.
Original driving game in years, allowing players to choose their own route through the city and generally cause the kind of havoc not seen since Tony Adams lost his license. Club GTI will be in arcades next March.
Dream team? Well, we're the mean team. Oh dear, terrible film.
At the moment is Space Jam, Warner Brothers' latest animated extravaganza featuring Michael Jordan digitally inserted into a cartoon world to help Bugs and Co. out with a spot of alien bother.
They want to make us slaves, so we challenge them to a basketball game.
Released in March, fans of the movie will be able to continue their animated fantasies with Space Jam on the Saturn and PlayStation from Acclaim, two basketball Michael. Games that bear an uncanny resemblance to NBA Jam on the Mega Drive, also from Acclaim. Like me, the problem with pets is they smell and cack all over the place. Well, now the nation's gone bonkers for Creatures on the PC, which allows you to nurture your very own virtual captive without the smell. You can hatch your little critter, treat it with love and affection, and you'll be able to sit back and feel smug as your well-balanced progeny frolics happily, learns about its environment, and even plays doctors and nurses with other fluffy mates.
Okay, welcome back. This is the girly show on Gamesmaster, something I've pioneered to have for a long, long time. That's why we're dressed a little bit differently. We've got Sarah Wade on the show, who's going to attempt to get through 3 platform games within the allotted time. Being hinged to my bracket is Kirk Ewing from Vizette. Kirk, there's something that's different about you today. What is it?
How nice of you to notice, Dominika. I am indeed not wearing my Wonder Bra.
That's what it is. Now, Kirk, the first game is Donkey Kong 3. What tips can you give Sarah on that?
Well, okay, you've got to guide your various collection of donkeys around.
I was wondering what happened to Kirk Ewing. I quite liked him. He was very straight talking.
That's it.
I think he worked for. Was it? I was going to say the Amiga format. I don't think it was actually.
Okay,
he definitely worked in some video game magazines.
Three games that Sarah has to play within 4 minutes. The first one is Donkey Kong 3. She's got to collect 30 bananas. We reckon she wants to do it within about 1 minute to leave herself lots of time for the other two. Best of luck, Sarah. Your time begins now. Okay, so off Sarah goes. In the top left-hand corner of the screen is the banana counter. She's got 6 already. We're looking for 30. There's another clutch of bananas here. Takes her up to 12. A good start, Kirk. Only 10 seconds gone.
Very good start. That's how I got both the monkeys in the troop now. That's Kitty, the big one you can see there in the front. Uh-huh. And one of them behind that's little Dixie with the ponytail.
Really impressive games, these Donkey Kong.
Next to children. I mean, okay, this is on the
SNES.
She hasn't quite made it. That's
you know,
tough
it was, I think it was rare it did that, you know, some of the graphics are kind of like ray traced. Really, really impressive. Not ray traced, they were CGI'd.
Back into the cannon. Wallop.
Okay, that's up there. Now we're back to this tricky jump again, because she can't hang about, Kurt, when she's on these barrels, because they're going down all the time.
Absolutely. If she makes this jump, you would say it's a classic gaming feat.
It's a fantastically classic gaming feat there. Okay, 47 seconds gone. We're looking for some more bananas, though, Kurt. Where are we likely to find some?
She's got to work her way up quite a bit higher, actually, along this platform, and then up in the top right. Further on, she'll find another, at least a few more bananas.
Okay, well, unfortunately, she's lost. Oh, no, I thought she. Yeah, she's lost the big monkey cut. We're just down the wee one now.
Here we go. That's 26 bananas now.
27. There was one more there, Kirk. 1:09 gone. We said she wanted to do it in about a minute, so she's behind schedule already, Kirk.
She is behind schedule, but she just chunks these last few barrels, another couple up here.
There we go. That's 30. That's it. Okay, fine.
That's challenge over.
Welcome back
Right, now this is the infamous scene. This was really where they pushed the boundaries of decency.
Zoe Ball is here. She's just making sure that she is shaving her pits and legs closer than I did this morning. Let's find out what she'll be playing.
This is when Zoe Ball actually looked quite nice.
Is one of the most dangerous sporting events in the world, and not a place we'd expect to find too many women. So it's with particular relish that I've ordered my next contestant to slip on her leathers and get out there and burn rubber. Her challenge will be to finish in the top five after two laps on the tire-screeching Manx TT. She'll be starting in eighth position, so to complete the challenge, she'll need to come from behind. Marvellous.
He's up there.
So, PVC panted up for this challenge. Please welcome the best reason for an early rise on Saturdays, Zoe Ball. Welcome to the show, Zoe.
Can I just comment on how fantastic you look? Can I have a little stroke?
Yes, you can certainly have a little stroke.
We have a problem here. We've got a VPL. With a dress like that, you shouldn't wear any pants.
Okay.
Just a bit of advice.
There is a contractual thing about male Channel 4 presenters must wear pants at all times. I also have a visible belly line as well, which I can't do anything about. But I am expecting.
I like it.
I am with child.
Oh, right.
As they say. Now, let's talk about getting up early in the morning. Because I would find that very difficult. Do you ever have any mishaps about having to get up that time?
Yeah, it's pretty horrible when you, because I'm renowned for being late anyway all the time. I'm always late, and a couple of times I overslept. And so you get this phone call saying, where are you? And you have that horrible drive to work where you just feel like you're probably going to be shot or something, lift up against the wall. And you walk in and it's like being, you know, at school and you walk in like that. And horrible, horrible. I actually missed a show once.
Totally?
Completely, yeah.
Did you get in trouble?
I did actually.
Get hit? Did they beat you with a stick?
I wish. No, they didn't actually.
So do you need any help again up early in the morning?
Thank you, no.
Because I know a very large, fat, bald, bearded Scottish alarm clock.
Really?
That you could use. and this is on a motorbike. Do you have a motorbike? Have you been on a motorbike before?
I'm actually terrified of motorbikes, but I like it at the back. On a motorbike.
And enough said. Okay then, Zoe, if you'd like to go and get your leg over this fine machine.
And the humour just ramps up.
And talk to another bloke in a skirt. And help me out, this computer games heavyweight, Rick Henderson. Rick, this is the 77th time I've seen you in a dress. Where did you get this particular one?
Well, I actually stole it from a small child, and he wasn't too happy about it either.
And what about this game then? What's the best advice you could give Zoe?
Well, the best advice is to keep your fingers very firmly tightened around the throttle. Mm-hmm. And when you actually get around a corner, release them slightly, go around the corner a bit wide, and also a checkpoint. Gives you 15 seconds extra to complete the challenge.
Can you just say throttle again once more?
Throttle.
That's good. I didn't think you stressed it quite enough the first time. Okay, Zoe has to finish in fifth place. The longer she can actually carry on the game then, the better. It's quite tough for her because she was quite abysmal in practice. So best of luck, Zoe. Start your engines. Okay, so we've clad Zoe in red leather for the purpose of this race. You can see her position in the top left-hand corner of the screen. In the top right-hand corner is a map of the track. The little flashing red triangle is...
Quite a good conversion of this on the Sega Saturn, if you're interested.
Place already. A good start, Rick.
That's a good start, but these are early doors. These are easy corners. She's going to have a lot of trouble later on. A bend could do this much.
Okay, then, so she rubbed that corner a little bit, and that's taken her down to sixth place. Though we've got a straight here. She can maybe want to take this guy.
Here comes the checkpoint. She's got 15 extra seconds there.
Okay, just going into quite a gentle banking left-hander there. Still in fifth, but there's a clutch. A lovely bunch she's got right up in front of her there, Rick.
This is a wide corner.
Oh,
she's
no,
taken it very well.
They've slipped inside her. A couple of them slipped inside Zoe there, but she's managed to knock one of them off. She's up to sixth again now, but she's got it in her sights, Rick. They're running out of time.
She's going to have to get a grip of that throttle control and get her thighs wrapped around completely.
I would like to see her holding it a little bit tighter myself, Rick. Okay, she's going into the right hand and she's back into seventh place, but 25 seconds. Still enough time to get into fifth, which is what a challenge is, Rick.
She's in a good position now to take the next checkpoint.
That's it, she's up in the front, she's into the wall, Rick.
This is wall tennis. It's Stonesville, USA.
13 seconds left. She's in seventh. If she can just take them on this bench, she can still get up to fifth. She's revving up there, she's taking the left under. Oh no, she's in the wall, she's going to slow down. I don't think she's
going to.
3, 2, 1, that is the time. She did get through in the finishing line, but let's just see, she finished in sixth. So by one place, Zoe's challenge ends in failure.
Bad luck, Zoe. You were doing quite well at the start there. Then what happened? What went wrong?
I was listening to you.
Uh-huh.
And,
always a bad mistake.
Yeah, absolutely. And also, I just, it's so difficult. You just have to concentrate so hard, and I'm useless at these kind of things.
You're not...
But I enjoyed it, though. You know, I don't think it was so bad, was it?
You're not the first woman to be captivated by the rolling lilt of my accent, Zoe, it has to be said. Well, Zoe, you haven't won the joystick.
I'm not at all surprised. I never thought I was going to win it, though, so at least I'm not disappointed.
Uh-huh. But you have captured my heart.
Oh, have I?
So I hope you can take that home as consolation.
Oh, darling.
For you. Thank you very much indeed for coming on.
Who writes your lines?
I make them all up.
Really?
Isn't it amazing? Do you know what I mean? I just find
I'm sure he does.
Here, or really? Sometimes lower down, and before I know it, it just come out. And that's it. But thank you very much for coming on. Always nice to have someone on who I fancy. That's
lovely.
What I say. I'm sure it's the same for you. Okay, boy.
And that is a wonderful Gamesmaster.
Thank you very much. Tonight's special guest, Zoe Ball.
Now, after Gamesmaster went off air in 1998, there was just nothing at all. There was no TV programmes at all about video games, which I always thought was quite incredible because, you know, it was a massive, massive industry, but there was just, for whatever reason, nobody wanted to make TV programmes about it. However, in 2004, one of the independent TV companies called Bravo, it was Bravo Channel, they brought out a TV programme called When Games Attack. Now, it featured the Gamesmaster host Dominik Diamond. So this is When Games Attack.
Broadcast as an alternative video game program, viewers should prepare themselves for games-related jokes, nonsense and general hijinks.
This program sadly went under the radar for most people because it was on Bravo. You know, unless you are a big Bravo fan, you probably wouldn't even know it was on. I don't know how I came across it. I think I just stumbled across it one day.
From the alternative world of video games today, an encounter with the Borg in Las Vegas. Can Beyond Good and Evil really better Zelda? The making of an old school classic, and gorgeous Michelle Marsh takes our dance challenge.
Now, this is when I was talking to Dominik. He told me that he basically had an absolute free-for-all making this programme. And that's why he has page 3 girls dancing in Dance Dance Revolution.
It's very important to treat your body like a temple, otherwise how else are people supposed to worship in it? Got another one of your letters here. This is from Delroy Donaldson from Bristol. Dear When Games Attack, I think that old games are best. Everybody else in the world thinks I'm an idiot. Who's right? Well, I'm afraid the rest of the world is right in this case, Delroy. Two words. Hungry Horace. What you've done, unfortunately, is fall into one of those traps of trying to be a little bit too cool. Please stop now, before you start liking bands like Gay Dad and Mudhoney.
The game nestling guiltily in the number one slot will be revealed in the second part. Coming up in the alternative video game show, I slip into something comfortable to meet the Borg, Zelda goes head-to-head with Beyond Good and Evil, and the number one game that should never be made into a movie. But first, it's over to Steve Morgan for our celebrity challenge as Michelle Mars tries to avoid putting out her own eyes.
Yes, thank you, Dominik. And it is Michelle now who adopts a barefooted approach to the dance challenge. And she should be very careful, actually, because I was on there earlier, barefooted. And she may pick up a verruca, as well as a couple of other nasty things as well. But she needs to put together a few combos and not just stand there with her hands together. She needs to dance.
For adults.
After all, this segment of the show is called the Dance Challenge and not the Stand There and Look Stupid Challenge, although I've got a feeling that may be what we may have to recall it after this. A performance by Michelle, who's just making up moves
she's
as she
absolutely
goes
fans.
Along. Look at that. I don't know
never
what she's
games.
Doing here right now, but oh my word, she's getting a few boos there and it doesn't seem to bother her. Oh, it's just gone dark. But she needs to see the light if she's going to salvage anything out of this whatsoever. Michelle, start dancing! Too late.
Oh my God!
I thought at one stage I was going to have to come in and rescue you there. You were floundering slightly there, Michelle. It was all going a bit...
Well, I'm a free spirit, you see. I like to do my own thing. I don't like being told what to do, so yeah. That's my explanation.
Yeah, I like the one stage you were just... You were with it, weren't you? There was a lot of movement. It was nothing to do with the game, but it was just
having fun.
It was almost like some art installation.
I know. I think I was just drunk again. Well, yeah. Nice excuse.
I mean, how did you find it? It's quite a tricky wee thing.
It's really hard to do. It's really hard.
Yeah. Is there anything at all, any challenge you've had that compares to that in your life? Anything that's as difficult as that?
No, not really. No. That's flabbergasted me completely.
Well, the score you got was 292,385.
No way!
Yeah, see, that sounds pretty good, doesn't it? Until you look at our league table, you see. And the good news is you're not bottom.
Oh, who's bottom?
Pixie. No, she's on the bottom, where I like her to be. And in fact, then you're just behind Katie Downs.
Okay.
Katie's, in fact, just on top of you.
Okay.
Again, just better and better, but you're some way off the lead.
Okay.
Kaylee, 1.9 million compared to your 292,000. That's quite a no.
Well, I'll let her have this one.
Yeah, it gives you something to aim.
I'll let her win, you know.
Doesn't it? That's, yeah. You're a very giving person.
Yeah, I know.
Come here. God. Okay. Anyway, join us in a couple of weeks' time for our fifth and final stage on the Special Dancing Challenge.
This bit is brilliant. This is where they review, they compare two games. Love this wee bit. Now these little soft toys actually belong to the producer of the programme, and he still has them.
Once again, viewers, it's time for another head-to-head. We take two games each with equal claim to be the best in their genre and put them head-to-head in a... What's all this about, ladies? You've bought some depleted uranium on the black market? And you're going to sell it to the highest bidder? Do you know the environmental implications could be bordering on apocalyptic? We'll talk about this later. Go and get your boxes. And let's dispose of this in a responsible manner. Today we're focusing on RPG fantasy adventures. Cuddly has rather rashly opted for Beyond Good and Evil, whereas Queenie's been far more sensible and she's plumped for Zelda the Wind Waker. Round 1. Gameplay.
Wind Waker offers the usual Zelda mixture of sword fighting, puzzles and errands. Though, as always, the quest itself involves a fair amount of wandering around. Beyond Good and Evil plays like an original blend of game genres, offering something for everyone.
I actually got into that game, Beyond Good and Evil, quite a bit a couple of years ago. As usual, just stopped playing it only, actually.
But which do you resume. Prefer?
It's going to be Zelda.
57% of the 100 gamers surveyed said Zelda the Wind Waker had the better gameplay. Round 1 to Zelda. 2 rounds to go.
Congratulations, Queenie! The gameplay of Zelda, a thrilling rollercoasting ride of emotion. The gameplay of Beyond Good and Evil, not. Round 2. Story.
Zelda the Wind Waker resurrects the well-trod story of a courageous young boy who's destined to become a hero and save a helpless princess. It's a classic tale that holds few surprises. Beyond Good and Evil's story sounds like it's taken from a Terry Pratchett novel, with an absurdity that has won favour with fans. Flying fish, a talking pig, and an Italian hologram all feature in a story about intergalactic war and TV news reporting. But which approach do you like the best? 71% of you said Beyond Good and Evil had the better story, meaning it pulls even in round 2. One more round to go.
Congratulations to Cuddly then, who's drawn at level by winning the story round, eh? You know how you did that, don't you? Because people out there are mental. Round 3. Graphics.
Placing Link in a cel-shaded world was initially controversial, but The Wind Waker proved to be a visually stunning game. The cartoon land designed with rich colours and textures is arguably more awe-inspiring than environments built with normal polygons. With Beyond Good and Evil, the artists have shown real visual flair. As well as building solid character animation and dazzling lighting effects, they've ditched FMV and rendered each cutscene with their standard gameplay graphics. But which game looks the best for you?
It's got to be Zelda.
62% of those surveyed thought Zelda The Wind Waker had better graphics. Round 3 to Zelda.
So yeah, I think this was Zelda probably, I love Gamesmaster, but I really enjoyed Wayne's Games Attack. I think because it was more adult-based. It was an excellent programme, just a shame it never went beyond the two series. No, it was only one series actually, 20 episodes.
The fact is, Beyond Good and Evil is a rubbish game. You didn't stand much of a chance. So because of that, we're not going to give you a forfeit this week. No, we're not. All I'm going to say is, just go and have a little check on the levels of that uranium there. No, your biohazard suit had to be dry cleaned. Yeah, no, it did. Seriously, it's fine. On you go. You don't need it. You're okay. Just looking at it. Just go. Have a little look. Oh, yeah. Join us next time for another head-to-head.
This last one, it actually started off as an internet program. I mean, this was before, we're talking before YouTube. There was a program that was put out on the internet. You know, you could only watch it online. And then it was picked up by the BBC as being quite popular. So they commissioned a TV program called Consolevania. It featured two Scottish guys. The main presenter was Robert Florence. So take a wee look at this. This is Consolevania.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to episode 2.6 of Consolevania. All right, pal. Oh, fans everywhere. Episode 2.6 of Consolevania. Fantastic reviews, ladies and gentlemen. Sensible Soccer 2006. You're looking at what else?
All up in chaos.
And I'll be looking at Hitman Blood Money on the 360 as well. And something else, a couple of poker games.
Yeah, like I said, this actually started off as just a fan-based... it wasn't a fan-based, it was these two guys. They made it in their own time and they uploaded it on the internet for people to watch. And because it proved so popular, the BBC decided to actually commission a proper TV series.
If being a gaming geek could be considered a religion, bear with me here, the god of gaming geeks has just answered a few of his spunk-stained, clammy prayers. Because Sensible Soccer is one of the games, you know, when it comes up in conversation, it's one of the games that brings a sigh and a nod of the head for an awful lot of people. Great times, great memories. So the announcement that there was to be a new Sensible Soccer in this day and age that we live in, where we have Pro Evolution and fuck all else, had us all whispering at each other because we couldn't quite believe it was going to happen, but here it is. As you would expect, there's no official licensing in the game, but you can edit the players' names back. This is Rimfister of Aberdeen fame, but I know what you're saying for. Here's the game. You're a gold star, a superstar hero. I might be going blind, or maybe it's the version of the game I got sent back. Couldn't I actually see Ronaldinho in this lineup? And I'm thinking maybe it's because he's the only player in the world whose likeness could be recreated in Sensi. Here's the actual real game. No, I kicked the arse off the old one, and I've went Brazil, obviously, because I want to give England a beasting. Here we go. Oh, for fuck's sake. I'm absolutely fascinated to know whether this game can sell nowadays. Will Joe Public have enough independent thought to recognise that this is a football game with football on the title, but it isn't actually realistic? Will he have enough control over his consciousness to comprehend that he won't be able to see represented as a number how fast Ryan Giggs can run? Or what he'd
that actually looks not too unlike, is it Sociable Soccer, which is the new one coming out for John Hare?
And it does actually look
very, very similar.
The guys at Codemasters are saying if this sells, they'll be bringing out more content, more versions. I mean, can you imagine playing this on live? I'm getting a semi just thinking about it. Now, I should have issued an apology at the start of the review for our American viewers. I know you don't like soccer. It's got too much skill and passion and all that bunkum that's got no place in sports. So sorry about that, lads. Having said it's not a kick in the arse off the old one, there is new stuff in it. There's this editing feature in it where you can make freaks of nature. What more would you want? Here's Revolver Ocelot, kinda. And his early days kept that quiet, didn't he? What was personally eerie for me is they wouldn't have known this making the game, but you can actually make a good likeness of me as well. That's me scored, our Mac. You know what I mean? It's like looking in a mirror. The game plays well. There, I finally said it. It's really good fun to play. But it does have its flaws. Creating a custom team and trying to build them up by playing the preset competitions is a chore by anybody's standards, a real test of patience. And the goalkeeper is a real freak of nature. He's capable of complete brilliance and utter insanity, but I can live with that. While I'm issuing apologies, actually, I should probably apologise to our Scottish viewers as well, because after I've challenged the Codemasters, it seems that they've wreaked their revenge by no putting our Scotland team. What's that all about, Codemaster? Sort it out. But it's got the magic.
No Scottish team?
No doubt about it.
Seriously?
When you're not into the game, it's solid fun. As a title, it's quite bare. It's quite thin in the ground. But it's a budget game, so what do you want? In one player, it can get a wee bit tired. A wee bit fast. Maybe tiles are iron rod. It can get a wee bit samey in one player, but in two player and in co-op play, it's pure gold. You just can't beat it, because you know the tension that you normally have when you're playing your mate at a football game. Well, now imagine that your mate can hit the ball for the halfway line and your keeper will let it in. It's violence guaranteed. So Sensible Soccer is back in their lives. I'm not accepting for a second that this is a one-off, that you'll pass this opportunity up. So go and buy it because it's cheap or because it's fun. Just go and buy it.
The DS is set to soar to the next level. In all, there will be more than 100 new games from DS from now until the end of the year. Take a look.
Quite sure what that was all about.
Kenny, Kenny, I've been oblivion. Is there any secrets?
You want a secret? Here's a secret. Your ma's shagging your uncle.
Kenny, Kenny, I'm still playing World of Warcraft. Have you got any tips for me?
Aye, here's a tip for you. Don't plan anything good for your life, because you'll be pregnant by 14, homeless by 16, addicted to heroin by 18, and by 20 you'll be fucking dead.
Brilliant.
Kenny, I want a new game for my birthday. What are the best games out now?
I'll tell you what the best game is, the new kick and fuck out of wee lass's dad, and I'm coming for yours. Yeah!
You should be able to find episodes of this online, just go and search for them. I don't think they ever released them on DVD, I would certainly buy them if they did.
Rare Team is 1-0. Codemaster shat it. Now it's your turn. You can put up a fight, can't you, Rare? Where's your dollar? Come and bring it. Team!
Alright, stop greeting, Stamper Brothers. Why your team coming for me? I'll tell you why we're coming for you. Because we've had it. We've had it with your sellout ways. Look, see that? Class. See this? Total class. See this coming up here? Total pish. Sort it out.
Maybe every cunt else is too scared to say so, Rare. But yous used to have it. Yous had a legacy back when yous were ultimate. And you used to bring out the crack wee games and put them in a beautiful wee box. Mind? You remember? Well, see when team are done with you, we'll put yous in a nice wee box as well and lower you into a fucking grave. Team!
Yo, Rare, I got myself some of that grab by the ghoulies last night. Know the game. Your ma.
Team! I used to have respect for you, Rare. I loved your games. You went all fat cat on me. Get it up. To Bill Gates, what happened to you? Team is here for you.
Cameo? Pish. You want to talk about a cameo? What about the cameo of your wee birds made in the porn film I shot?
fluffing all the guys while they get ready to shag all the beautiful bungee teams, buds. That's right there. I says your buds aren't as good looking as bungees, buds.
It's quite surprising just how what they actually got away with, considering this is on BBC.
Hi, it's me. I'm here to do the intro for my game review that I'll give you a bit of background and stuff on it so
what
that
you...
It's me doing the intro for the Turban Chaos game.
Turban Chaos? It's Urban Chaos!
Is it?
Silly boy, isn't
oh.
it?
Oh. Urban Chaos Riot Response comes from a company called Rocksteady. Now, I've never played a Rocksteady game, so I have no doggone idea what to expect. So I get the game on for the first time, and it's an FPS. And all you regular listeners know, I'm just not all that keen on FPSs. I never have been. But this one is different, because Urban Chaos is pure fucking trash. Utter shite, but it's shite with pure energy.
Never played that myself.
You use your
is that the Xbox,
move
is it?
In the game, and that's what no, you do
probably
you
Xbox
finish.
And PS2,
always
I'm guessing.
Forward, you're always blowing heads off, and that's all you want for an FPS. You want to be able to shoot a guy once.
Anyway, listen, guys, that is the slightly left field Consolevania. Go and check it out. If you like your sort of your video game stuff
really
a wee bit different,
that's what you
you'll
want,
probably quite enjoy that.
So that is it, guys. That is the last of the programmes we're going to look at. Now, the last sort of TV programme went off air when Games Attack, it went off air in 2005. I don't recall there being any other TV programmes based on video games. I mean, there is one that's currently showing, what's it called? Go 8-bit or something like that, whatever it is. It's only on for 6 episodes, but why has there not been any programs based on video games since? I think we probably know the answer. It's probably down to the internet. I mean, the thing is, before the internet came along, you know, the only source of information on video games you had was magazines or the TV. Now, since the internet has come along, you know, it's we're getting everything right away. You know, as soon as a game comes out, as soon as a games console comes out, you get to see it. You can go into Reddit, you can go to any channel on the internet and you can find it right away. So I think the internet has probably pretty much killed you know, TV programmes, video game TV programmes. I mean, you're sitting watching me here just now, so stuff like YouTube, there's, you know, there's a plethora of computer programmes about all different systems and that. So I think the internet has pretty much killed any hope of another TV program airing, you know, which is a shame, because I mean, you know, some of the TV programs, especially Gamesmaster, it was iconic. It'll always be fondly remembered. But when I was talking to Dominik Diamond in my interview, I asked him, you know, could he ever imagine there being another Gamesmaster? And he said no, just for that very reason. He said that back then, that was the provider of news, video games news and that kind of stuff. But now we've got the internet, you've got YouTube, you've got all these different channels. So that is really, it's kind of, it's just made TV redundant as far as video games goes. But, you know, maybe one day there might, you know, we might give Dominik Diamond enough money and he'll come back and make a, is it a 8th series of Gamesmaster? But if any TV company are out there looking for a Scottish presenter, a fat, bald Scottish presenter, and Dominik can't manage it, then can I put my hand up? So, anyway, listen, guys, that is it. I hope you enjoyed watching this. It's been quite fun to actually take a look at all these old programmes again. But as usual, guys, thank you very, very much for watching.